Okay. I just.
Ha ha! She's working while we're podcasting.
Yeah.
It's what you do, right? You multitask very well, don't you?
Yes, I'm always juggling a lot of things.
Yes, I thought so. Well, amazing audience, we are live with Laura Peterson. It's amazing. I had a conversation with her. It was as colorful as this book looks. Yeah, she really represents color, right? Like, she didn't, but Laura Peterson.
Has to pop.
Laura Peterson is an amazing individual that I really have the pleasure to interview this morning. I did interview her on the 12-Minute Convos podcast, and now we get to meet face-to-face, which is so amazing, right? She is the host of a few things. Like, I know the copy that pops, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then when I was, like, reading here, I saw, like, executive producer of Live to Grind.
I'm not doing that anymore.
Okay, and co-founder of Potent.
Not doing that anymore.
All right, cool.
It's just all copy that pops now.
Boom.
All
let's
in.
Do that.
Boom.
So tell us, what's the update? Like, last time we spoke, I think the thing that stuck out the most is your favorite song at 12, right? I did go research that after. I was like, all right, that's cool. And then we spoke about, like, your joy for what you do, right? It seems as though you carry, like, this huge like this huge element of energy around what you do, right? So tell us, what's the update? What's going on?
Well, yeah, to fill people in, my favorite song at 12, I think you asked me about, and that was Baby Got Back.
Yeah, I like how you did that.
Which is maybe a weird choice, but that was so popular back in the 90s, and I knew all the world, all my friends, and I would just, like, go through the whole thing over and over and over again, so it's kind of funny. And now when I listen to it now, I'm like, whoa, those words are bad for kids to be singing. But you don't really know what you're saying back then, you know. But yeah, I was a big nerd in school, and I didn't get exposed to entrepreneurship until I was about 21. My dad gave me the book Rich Dad Poor Dad, so that book completely changed my life. And I tried to start businesses, but that was in the, like, mid-2000s, and the internet isn't like it is now, and I kind of couldn't figure it out. So I ran back to what I know, which is teaching and education, and I was a high school teacher for a while, and I loved that. I loved working with kids, but I felt like I just couldn't fit into this, like, box of society. Mm. So for some reason, there's something that kept drawing me to entrepreneurship. And so I stopped teaching full-time about 7 years ago, 6 or 7 years ago, and jumped into business, tried a bunch of things, and just feel like it's ultimately my calling. Yeah. So I think that's why I have so much energy for it.
Well, it could be the natural energy you have. You know, it's just amazing that was the song that you connected with, right? It, probably the words, not, but definitely that.
The energy,
that energy.
I love dancing. Yeah.
There we go. So you're doing a podcasting, right? You're representing this. Like, you know that you've done so much business, how to grow your podcast, brand, business, sorry, which
with
really
writing.
Connects.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, with compelling copy. Now tell us, what's the biggest challenge that podcasters are having with copy?
Yeah, well, I think a lot of podcasters maybe start a podcast, or entrepreneurs start a podcast because they recognize the importance of creating content and getting out there. And maybe they're drawn to it because they feel like they can speak better than they can write. So they're like, I don't want to write a blog or whatever. But they might then neglect the importance of writing to get found by the bots and the search engines, and then also to actually connect with someone who's maybe discovering your podcast for the first time.
Mm.
It's that writing, the words that they're seeing first before they actually decide to click play or subscribe to your show. So they often maybe put it to the wayside and don't realize how important copy can be to actually get people attracted and pulled into your podcast so that they can actually hear your episodes.
Yeah, very important, folks. Like, I'm the guy that did that in the opposite. Like, I have not been doing a good job of putting out copy there. What's the best way? Like, in my mind, though, I'm like, I don't want to read this book.
I know, it's a little long.
I'm like, how do I hire you? Like, what's the best way to do that? Like,
well, I actually don't do professional copywriting anymore. I know.
Okay.
Because it's funny. So I actually wrote this book at the end of 2016. I started my show in April 2016. And I wrote my first book at the end of that year. And I did it in 30 days. I know, it's really big, right? And I still did it in 30 days. And I figured out how to hit bestseller on Amazon in a relevant category. And so many people started reaching out to me saying, how did you do that? That in 2017, I just started helping people do it with their books. I created a course. I started taking private clients. And now that's why some of the things you asked me about on the back of the book, I don't do anymore, because I just got such a demand from the market around helping others to write and self-publish their books to help grow their brand and business, that that's what I exclusively focus on now.
That's so good.
As of yesterday, I have 21 success stories with books that have hit number 3 or higher, with like 98% of them hitting number 1 in their categories.
Wow. Yeah. Where's the best place for people to connect with you on that?
Yeah, so go to copythatpops.com, and that's the hub for everything. So I've got a blog with really epic, because I can write, obviously, I'm like a nerd for writing. I have these epic blog posts that will really help you out completely for free, podcast episodes on it. I also, one more thing I could say is, if you go to copythatpops.com/Facebook, it'll redirect you over to a free Facebook community that I have that's all around helping people to write, self-publish, and launch their best-selling books completely for free.
Okay.
And of course, if you want to work with me further, I've got paid stuff you can look into. But that's a good place to start.
No, definitely. Because there's some people that just want to cut through and get what the work, you know, just get the work that needs to be done. I love that. I love what you're doing. Yeah, this is wonderful. Now this.
So my second book,
right?
This one is called Permission to Write a Brand Building Book for Podcasters. It's really for anyone, but I niched it down for podcasters. 9 myths holding you back from more exposure and making a greater impact. So what I found with working with these 21 people, and even more people too who are in the process right now, is that a lot of us have, and I've had it too, this imposter syndrome feeling, like, who am I to write a book? Like, I'm not expert enough, I'm not good enough, I'm not experienced enough. And so this book is all about busting all those myths and giving you permission. Yes, you are good enough right now to write a book. The world is waiting, people are waiting. So let's just put those all to the wayside and jump on in. So this book is really about just, I felt like so many people in working with me, the number one thing we had to bust through first was they're not feeling good enough to actually do it. And I was like, you are, let's go. So that's what I wrote that book about.
I love that. Copy That Pops. Baby, you got back. It's all connected.
Right. Yeah. If you want to go dancing, let me know. I love salsa and hip hop. That's it.
I think the owner of EuroHub, where we are right now, I think she has like this huge dancing flair. I was looking at her TED Talk and she loves, like, she just sets
up.
Yeah, definitely. She just sets up parties on the streets. Like, she loves to dance. So do check that out. Well, one of the segments we cover is your own unique grill shoes, and it speaks to shoes that you've worn across the time of your life, right? What are some types of shoes you've worn between 1 to 12, 12 to 24,
oh,
and so forth? Yeah, tell me, please.
That's an interesting question. Okay, so when I was younger, I would have to say no shoes.
Oh, really? Barefoot.
I hated dresses, which is ironic because I'm wearing a dress now, and I hated shoes. So I was always like kind of more tomboy and just running around playing, trying to get all the shoes off me. I hated them.
And this is like, what, up to 12, or is it?
Probably. I mean, of course you had to wear them like at school and stuff, but if I was at home and playing, I just wanted to be barefoot.
And then after, teenagers.
Well, yeah, so what comes to mind first is basketball shoes, because I played basketball.
Well, you do have the height of a basketballer, right?
For sure.
Did you love that?
I did. I always did independent sports. So I did gymnastics when I was younger, and my dad was like, you need to be in a team sport so you can learn like all the skills that come with being a team player. And he first tried to put me in soccer, and I was like, I hate this, like, get me out. And he was like, all right, how about basketball? And I was like, all right, I'll try it. And then I ended up loving it, and I played it all through high school.
What about after? Like, I know you're married,
yeah?
So what type of shoes between that time?
Well, first I would jump before getting married, because I got married when I was, like, 32.
All right.
So I would say, like, in my 20s, my shoes were salsa dancing shoes.
Okay, sweet.
I still have my first salsa dancing shoes that I bought in, was it 2001?
Wow.
And they're like falling apart. I still wear them. I love them. They're just like fit me so perfectly. So I'd say salsa dancing shoes were next.
Does he?
And then
salsa?
No.
Oh, all right. You need to salsa one. All right. And then,
And so then maybe now I would say the first thing that comes to mind is like flip-flops. Okay. I love the San Diego weather. I'm originally from Southern California. I've lived in different places in the world, and now I'm back in Southern California, and I just, flip-flops are my go-to.
It's like the entrepreneur's advantage.
Yeah, it's fast to put them on, always comfortable. It's like practically barefoot, back to my roots.
That's good, that's amazing. Do you have any regrets from that space of time to now in your life? Do you have, you could share or
which
not
space
share.
Of time?
Well, let's do from just looking back in hindsight, you know, from being the person who was barefooted, tomboyish, to being the person that that played basketball, to you being who you are today. Do you have any regrets?
So I have two answers. So first I would say no, because I think that you do the best that you can at the time. So I don't think that there's any value in feeling bad and having regrets. But if there is something that I could change, I would say that I wish I didn't feel so scared to put myself out there, specifically like with public speaking. Because that's something that I kept telling myself, the story of like, I'm scared of public speaking, or I'm not good enough, kind of like what people do with books. So I think that I held myself back for too long and kind of, I don't know, just thought I needed other people to be a business partner with because I wasn't good enough at sales, or I needed to stay in the stands and not raise my voice and not be on stage. So I think I just held myself back for too long, and now it's time to fix that and inspire other people, especially women, to do it more too.
Love it, love it. What are you most excited about right now?
Okay, so I'm flying to Lisbon, Portugal in September to speak.
Sweet.
And then I'm flying to Australia in October to speak.
Sweet.
So I decided to say, I'm not scared of public speaking anymore. I don't suck at it. Let's go.
Yeah, bring it.
Yeah,
I love that. When you heard that this guy from the Caribbean was coming to meet you, what did you think?
It's like, okay, let's go. I love international everything.
Yeah.
I love traveling. I love meeting other people. I love...
How many places have you been?
I've been to 41 countries.
Wow.
So by the end of the year, I'll be up to 44, because I've never been to Portugal, Australia, and New Zealand.
So how has it impacted who you are today?
I think recognizing that just because something you've done over and over again and everyone around you does it a certain way doesn't mean it's right or doesn't mean it's the best way. I love America, fuck yeah, but... other countries are doing things better than we are, so it's really great to go and explore and see other different ways and just get new perspectives and be more open-minded, I'd say.
I love it. Well, amazing audience, again, you're hearing it live from Laura Peterson. Laura, you heard this guy came from the Caribbean, right? He has a podcast, right? You have your podcast. What would you tell someone that's listening that they should do, who wants to launch out and what they want to do?
Around a podcast?
Well, let's say anything, because there's a podcast, there's the authorship,
Yeah, with anything, I would say that you should pick a launch date. Pick a date. I don't care what it is, pick a date, sooner than later. And you need to make it public. Say it over and over and over and over and over again. I'm going live October 10th, 10-10, this year, whatever. Just keep saying it, because you will never be ready. There will always be more things you want to make better. But if you have a public, visible date and commitment, you will not want to let other people down. So you'll actually follow through. And your future self will thank you, because taking action forward is the only way to get clarity and momentum. So it's better to do things sooner than later.
I love it. Amazing audience, hearing it live here again from Laura Peterson. Laura, thank you for being on What is Inspired by 12 Minute Convos with Engel Jones.
Thank you for having me.
Boom. Did you have fun, Laura?
I had so much
fun.